Presented by Forge Gin. My name is Ryan Royster.
And I'm Byron Hughes.
We are the founders of the Last Supper Society. We treat every meal like it's our last. Thank you so much for joining us. It is 2021. We are celebrating a new year, more life, all those good things. It is a new year, but we're keeping the same energy. So the first thing we're going to do is show you guys a conversation that we had with tonight's guests, who is someone who is truly a force of nature. We cannot wait for you to get to know her a little more later, but please check out the sip, this conversation with Alicia Garza. Pour yourself something to drink and enjoy. What started as a hashtag she coined in 2013 in the wake of the tragic and unjust killing of Trayvon Martin has grown into the international movement we now know as Black Lives Matter. 7 years later, she has become one of the country's leading civil rights organizers and activists and recognized as one of Time Magazine's 100 most influential people of 2020. Joining us for the sip, we are humbled and delighted to welcome Black Lives Matter co-founder and author of The Purpose of Power, Alicia Garza. Alicia, thank you so much for having us, for joining us on The Sip. This is our pleasure. We are super humbled and grateful for your time and your energy and your activity today.
Thank you for having me. I'm excited to be here with y'all.
Thank you so much. Let's dive right in. There's a Tupac quote, one of my favorite quotes from his, and he says, "I'm not saying I'm gonna change the world, but I guarantee you that I will spark the brain that will change the world." And that's our job, is to spark somebody else watching us. Tell us a little bit about your book, The Purpose of Power, and if you share that sentiment in regards to sparking and igniting people and movements.
Well, this is part of the reason that Pac was one of the greatest rappers, is one of the greatest rappers to ever do it, is because he's 100% correct. I do believe actually that the way to change the world is to spark the creativity and imagination and courage that people need to step out on faith, the things that, you know, we know in our souls, but we can't quite yet see it, and to make an impact on the world around us, to make it better than we inherited it, and to make it better for everybody, not just for some people. And I really wrote this book because I wanted to do just that, to spark people's creativity, their curiosity, but bigger than that, to spark their courage to see themselves as a superhero in their own story. You know, the story of movement so often is that there's a superhero that parachutes in and saves everybody's lives. And unfortunately, those are just fairy tales. They are the things of comic books and cartoon shows, but they are not the things of real life. The way that change happens in real life is that everyday people decide not only that they're sick and tired of being sick and tired, but that they are gonna do something about it. And so this book is really, I call it the breadcrumbs that are trying to help lead people to what their role is in a movement and what kind of superhero they're going to be in their own stories. The Purpose of Power is really about how we build the kinds of movements for this century, how we put more power into the hands of more people, and how we build and sustain and transform how power operates so that we all have a chance to be free.
I love that. Well, we're coming to the close of a year that saw a reckoning with racism and an activation of people like we haven't seen maybe since the civil rights movement. What are key lessons from the book that can serve as motivation for the many of us that are quite frankly exhausted right now, that are tired, that we're out on the front lines using our energy for this fight, but are now just exhausted? What can we look for as far as hope for a better future and a better 2021?
Yeah. Well, one of the things that I talk about in the book is that it is important for us to fight back against the cynicism that can creep in from exhaustion, from feeling like change is happening too slowly, all the things. And I talk about how, you know, I've been doing this work for a long time. And at a certain point, I realized that my cynicism was actually, it was blocking my ability to imagine what it is that we're trying to build. The fact of the matter is that the characteristic of movements that I think people don't take seriously enough is that we're working really hard to build something that we've never seen before. And so of course it's going to be exhausting. Of course it's going to be tiring. But if we are cynical about our ability to do it, then it blocks our ability to imagine what it is that we're trying to build in the first place. And that blocks our ability to actually fight strategically for it. So I don't know about you, but what gets me out of bed every day is not all the things that are wrong in the world. It's the possibility that we can make it right. And so I really encourage all of us to invest in our hope muscles. Now, hope is not the absence of despair, and I say this in the book, but it is the presence of being connected, right, to our purpose. I know for me, my purpose is to build power for Black communities, to make our communities powerful in the political process so that we can be powerful in the rest of our lives. And it keeps me going when I feel like things are going too slow, when I feel tired or exhausted, or when I feel like we may not get there. What I know is that when I connect to my purpose, it allows me to access the hope that I have.
Alicia, thank you so much for your time, for your insight. We cannot wait to get in the kitchen with you and cook this 2021 prosperity meal to get our year kicked off right. Any last words for, any parting words for the people as we sign off here?
Feet on the ground, head in the sky, eyes on the prize.
That was truly, I mean, we were sitting there, we were just quiet and in awe of her just dropping knowledge on us. We are happy and humbled to welcome the co-founder of Black Lives Matter, a Time Magazine's 100 Most Influential People of 2020, the author of The Purpose of Power, and so much more. We're not even doing her justice. Welcome, Miss Alicia Garza.
Alicia, hey. How are you? Hi, y'all. It's good to be with you. Happy New Year.
Happy New Year to you. And you have a birthday coming up, too.
I do on Monday, 40 and fabulous. You know, ooh, we're doing a
okay.
thing.
Okay. Happy birthday. Happy birthday.
Thank you.
So again, diving right in. You know, you have been so impactful and influential, not only this year, but going back over, you know, most of this last decade, but you have not centered yourself in this movement. And that's something that I really admire about you, is that you are just feet on the ground doing the work, but you're not the influencer activist. Tell me a little bit about your role, especially now, being in 2021 and with social media and everything, how you stay so focused on the work and not on everything else.
Oh my gosh. Well, first of all, thank you for the compliment. And second of all, because there's so much work to be done, literally there's so much work to be done. And I always say that, you know, movements are about putting more power into the hands of more people. And so we know that we're successful, right? If movements don't hover around one or two or even 20 individuals, right? But if it is comprised of many, many people who see this movement as their own. And I think for me, what I stay focused on is that we have so much work to do and not enough vehicles or people to do it. And so every single day, I'm just grinding to make sure that we have the right vehicles to make our communities powerful in every aspect of our lives. That's what I do with the Black Futures Lab. It's what I do with the Black to the Future Action Fund. In fact, my team isn't on break yet, actually. We've taken like a day off here and there for the holiday, but we are at doing our part to really turn out and motivate and mobilize voters in Georgia for the upcoming runoff election, which is happening next week, the day after my birthday. And then also trying to make sure that, you know, democracy stays intact. So January 6th is a big day. So, you know, all the stuff that's coming from here forward is really making sure that there are enough hands to make this work lighter, and also taking advantage of this moment and this opportunity where we've ushered in a new administration. And now it's time to make sure that they are moving the agenda that we want to see and that actually brought us to the polls. So that's how I do it, and that's what we're up to.
Beautiful. As we, even though movements have always been, the most successful movements in this country have always been people-centric, the way that we learn about them was we always learn about the central figures. We always learn about MLK and so on and so forth. Do you find it challenging as you and your team and everybody with boots on the ground are building this very publicly and openly people-centric movement, that are people often looking for that leader or like that superhero that you've talked about earlier?
Oh my gosh, all the time. And actually, you know, I was laughing just, I can't remember if it was yesterday or the day before, but you know, every single day in my inboxes and my social media, I get things from people that are basically directives, you know, because they think that I am the leader. So they're sending their missives to me about what they think I need to be doing and telling the movement to do. And sometimes it annoys me, but most of the time I just chuckle because, you know, there is not one person that can pick up a red phone and be like, everybody turn up or everybody turn down. And this is especially true when it comes to things like language. I mean, here we are 7 years later and I'm getting people in my socials who are like, I have the best, brightest idea. You guys should just call it Black Lives Matter too, and not just Black Lives Matter. And I'm like, you're actually not the first person to think about that. But also, I think we're doing okay, right? So I say all this with a lot of humility too. I mean, here's the thing. We get told fairy tales every day about how change happens. And if we believe those fairy tales, then what we think is that, you know, people like Martin Luther King descended from the sky and he snapped his fingers and everybody started marching and, you know, sitting in at lunch counters, but that's not actually how this happened. Right. So much of the history that we learn is condensed into small sound bites, and it really takes away the opportunity to understand the complexity. So, you know, for me, what I always say is, you know, if you have an idea, that's awesome. Test it out. You don't need me to test it. You can test it out yourself. If you have a song that you want people to hear, play it. If you have an idea for a new group to start, start it. If you have an idea for what your legislators need to be doing, call them. Because you are actually the leader that you're waiting for. Don't wait for me, because I'm moving. But we're waiting for you to get active and get motivated.
I love that. I know people are getting hungry and ready to get on this stove. Tell us real quick just about what's your game like in the kitchen?
You know, I do a thing. I have actually already made my New Year's meal, and I posted the results on my Instagram yesterday. Fried fish, black eyed peas, cabbage, because it's a long story. Yeah. But usually I do collards. I also did a potato salad, which was not pictured. And as I sat down to eat, I was like, my potato salad. But by that time I was deep in it. And I did a cornbread muffin. Nice. And it was delicious.
Beautiful, beautiful. So I'm going to get out of the way and I'm going to let you guys get on this stove. I'm going to give it over to Chef. Yes, I will be in the comments. If you guys have questions for me, if you have questions for Alicia, throw them in the chat. We'll try to answer as many as possible, but let's get to cooking. Appreciate you guys. Yeah. Let's get it.
Thanks, Ryan. Hi, everyone.
Let's go. All right, Chef, show me.
Happy New Year. Alicia, I am so honored to be here with you cooking right now. And, you know, we're doing fried fish again. I hope you don't mind eating it multiple times in a week.
I could never mind eating multiple servings of fried anything.
Perfect. Perfect. Okay, so we're going to jump right into this thing, you guys. Per usual, I like to just kind of take an inventory of what we've got in our bags. So we'll do that. very quickly. Please get your bags out if you don't already have them. Oh, and if you did not read the instructions, your oven should be preheated to 400 degrees right now. We're gonna finish our fish in the oven. Slightly different method of frying fish, so hope you guys enjoy this. Okay, let's do this. Number one, we have our fish. This fish came from, well, it came from Alaska, but we get it here in Sacramento from Sunfish. Shout out all the homies over there. They take such good care of us. This is Alaskan true cod. We originally were gonna do rock cod, but I think the weather was causing causing some issues up where they fish for the rock cod, so we went with the true cod instead. This is more of a typical fish for like anytime you have beer battered fish or like a fish taco, usually it's some kind of cod. So this should be pretty familiar to most people. Number two, we've got our black-eyed peas. Now let's just talk about these components and what this dish means for just a second for those who may not be initiated. So in black culture, it is very common for us to eat black-eyed peas on New Year's Eve. New Year's Day. New Year's Day, excuse me. I've been saying New Year's Eve this whole time. I don't know why. New Year's Day. So the black-eyed pea is specifically are meant to represent coins or pennies. That is, for good fortune for the coming year. And then oftentimes you see them paired with collard greens and cornbread. The collard greens representing money or cash money, dollars, and then the cornbread representing gold. And that's just, again, it's just meant to be like this good fortune meal that you have on the first day of the year. It's like, let's get you set up to have a very prosperous, successful year, mainly financially, I guess. I don't know what that's about, but. That's what we're working with here. We're flipping it though. We're gonna change it and do it our own way. So we got the black-eyed peas. They're already soaked. We soaked them for you guys. I'm a huge proponent of using dried beans. I don't like the canned stuff. It just doesn't taste the same. So these are already soaked for like 24 hours. We'll cook them, cool them, and then turn it into a salad. That'll be our pennies. Next, we got some basmati rice. This actually came from up here near Sacramento as well. Nothing remarkable here. Just very fragrant basmati rice. We'll mix that with the turmeric paste, which is a little bit of paste in this large container for whatever reason. I don't know why we did that, but we will flavor our rice and it'll color the rice too. It'll actually turn the rice gold from the turmeric, and that will be our gold component that'll replace the cornbread, which is also a starch too, so it kind of makes sense. Turmeric paste. Also, you guys have a container of oil. This is special oil. When I'm frying, I typically like to use this oil. This is rice bran oil, so it's made from rice. It's got a super high smoke point, so it can handle like high heat, intense cooking and frying and jobs like this. And just the flavor transfer and when I say flavor transfer, you know, the flavor that comes from the oil and flavors the food that's cooking in it. It's actually a pleasant flavor. So excited to be showing that if you haven't seen that before. What else do we got? We got our green, our dollar bills, y'all. In this bag, you have some leaves of parsley and you have some cilantro. The parsley will go in, it'll mix into the salad, and the cilantro will be our little garnish at the end. So we got all kind of green. You guys are gonna get so much money this year. I can't wait. So all this green, all that money. What else we got? Another green thing. We got a lime. This will be our acid for our salad, our acidic component. This salad is actually inspired by a Senegalese salad, which is pretty similar. It's got a little bit more heat, a little bit more spice to it. But the basics of it are black-eyed peas, lime juice, some bell pepper, and then a scotch bonnet or, you know, some type of spicy chili. Lime. What else we got? Avocado. Nothing crazy here. We'll mix that into our salad as well. We can either mix it in or we can garnish with it. It's totally up to preference. I think I'm gonna mix mine into the salad. What else do we got? Bell peppers. Like I said, the salad, Senegalese salad, typically has bell peppers in it. So you guys got these little cute little guys right here. What else do we got? Our panko. So this is our breading for our fish. Panko, Japanese breadcrumbs. They're very light. They get super crispy when you fry them. I love this stuff. But we also mixed in some shredded and dried coconut. So if you guys have ever had coconut, like coconut shrimp, for example, that's how it's made. And we're just kind of flipping that and using it on fish. Something I just came up with on a whim. And once we tested it, we loved it. And super happy to be sharing it. There's a couple things on there that's not listed. What else we got? We got a habanero. Watch out for that guy. You need to be able to distinguish the habanero from the bell peppers. The habanero is going to have more grooves in it. The bell peppers will be more, I don't know how you say, more flush, I guess. And then the habanero stem is much thinner than the bell pepper stems. And if you're absolutely confused about which one, just taste it. You could literally just run your finger on it and put it on your lip, and you'll know if it's a habanero or not, I promise. Cucumber, that'll go in our salad as well. And we also have more green scallions. This will go in our salad as well. Woo! What's that? Okay, here we go. We're moving along, guys, moving right along. Let's talk about what kind of equipment we're gonna need. First up, we'll need a small pot with a lid. This will be for our rice. Small pot, lid. Let's look at these pot sizes too, my hands for reference, yeah. Small pot with the lid for the rice, and then the larger pot. So, I've gone up maybe 2 or 3 quarts in the size. This will be for our beans. We always wanna make sure our beans are cooking in plenty of liquid so that they can retain their texture. They don't get all mushy or dry up or anything like that. So we're gonna cook the beans in a lot of liquid in that pot. You need a mixing bowl for the salad. And then you need a pan to fry in. I am going to use this kind of like it's still heavy bottom, but like this like shallow, wide pan. Just because I'll be able to do all my fish at once in here. That's a plus for me. But whatever you got, cast iron works here. Pretty much anything. It just needs to be fairly large. You don't want to be working with a small pan when we're frying like this. What else? Last thing you'll need, guys, is some kind of baking sheet. Totally fine if you don't have one like mine. This is just very chefy. Mine has a little rack in it. This is just how I do proteins in the oven. If you don't have a rack, so it's totally fine. You just need to have some kind of surface, some kind of vehicle to put the fried fish on so that we can finish it in the oven. This method of frying is, I don't want to say it's healthy, but it's not fully deep fried. We're actually, like I said, finishing it in the oven. So we get a different texture of the fish, different cook on it. And it's a little bit less fatty. I prefer it this way. Okay, I think that's everything. Everybody's got their ovens to 400. How are we doing, guys? Alicia, you ready? You got your oven on?
I'm ready. Oven's preheated. Let's do it.
Let's do this.
Everybody in the chat, hope you have a little something to sip on to celebrate as we're going. You can let us know what you are sipping on, your wines, if you got the wine pairings or what. But let's get it popping.
Let's get it popping, y'all. Okay, so first thing we need to do is get the beans going. This is not rocket science. We want to get our medium-sized pot. And we're going to strain these beads off. You don't need a strainer, just use the container. Just like slightly lift it and pour all that water out. And we're gonna rinse these one time too. Get all that old bean water kind of rinsed off of them. Okay. I'm just gonna get a little cold water here. And again, put that lid on, secure the beans and drain it. Got our beans drained now. What is that? They have a phone in here? Sorry guys, we found a phone.
All right, intercom or something.
Intercom system. Interesting.
We're all good though.
Yeah, we're all good.
Let's keep it popping.
Keep it popping. Okay, so we got the beans drained. We rinsed them one time in cold water. Now what we're gonna do here, guys, we're just gonna cover these beans with like 2 inches of water. There's no measurement here. We're probably all using different size pots. But we want there to be a solid like 1.5 to 2 inches of water above the beans. So I've added 16 ounces, probably take another 16 ounces. This is a 16-ounce container that it came in, by the way, guys. Fine. Good. Again, we just want to make sure there's plenty of water in there so that the beans don't dry out and get mushy and cook all weird. Avoid that. We will not be seasoning this until we actually get them cooled off and everything, too, guys. So don't worry about it. We're literally just going to get them cooked right now. So I want you to get those beans with plenty of water over a high flame. We're gonna bring it up to a boil first. And then as soon as it hits a boil, we'll reduce it to a simmer and we'll cover it and let it do its thing over the course of this entire process. That's the beans, guys. I'll give you a second here while I do a little cleanup. So Alicia, how do you make your black eyed peas? Like you said, you made them yesterday, right, or a day before yesterday?
Yeah, well, I soaked them the night before, and then I also did my turkey stock. So I boiled some smoked turkey wings, saved the stock, put the turkey wings aside because I like to have the little meat in mine. And then I cooked them slow. I put some red pepper flakes. A bay leaf and just let them cook and then add some seasoning along the way. Keep tasting them.
Nice. Love it.
You cook them in the stock. Yeah. So you drain them and then cook them in the stock and it's really good.
Yeah. Yeah. Smoked turkey stock. We actually made like 50 gallons of that stuff earlier in the season for a different episode.
That sounds so good.
That's awesome that you make stocks. Okay, so let's keep moving, guys. I think next we should probably get our rice going. That is the second longest process that we have on the menu today. So again, we're gonna rinse this stuff. We can do it inside of this container. Or you can do it, it's a little easier to do it in like a bowl, like a kind of a bowl situation. But if you don't have a big bowl or anything, you could use it right in the container. But here's the method. So, we'll add some water to this rice. And basically what we're gonna do is with our fingers, I kind of have my hand in this like claw formation right here. we just kind of just go in the rice and we're just rinsing the rice. We're kind of having that friction cause some of that starch to rinse off of the rice because this stuff will affect the cooking process. We wanna have nice fluffy rice, so we wanna get rid of some of that excess starch. And what you'll see when you get that motion in there is that the water immediately starts turning super cloudy. And we basically want to do this a couple times until the water is a lot less cloudy. Okay? So it's probably never going to run clear. So don't worry about that. But we want to do at least two or three times. And then when I pour it out from this bowl, I'm doing it real slow so the rice doesn't fall out. Here we go. I think we've done this on a different episode too, guys, if you've been with us. Okay, there's the water. Do it one more time. This time we'll go a little bit more aggressive with it. Rinse in the rice. Just getting even clearer. Clearer? Clearer? Is that a word?
More clear.
More clear? All right, here we go. You know, I'm from California. We tend to be making up our own types of slang up here in the northern part of it. So sorry if you guys don't understand my lingo sometimes. Okay, so last rinse here. We can see that the water is, I can see through the water now. I can see the rice at the bottom. That's a good sign. And I think that's good enough for me. For this amount of rice, it's perfect. Beans coming up to a boil soon because I got these super burners behind me. And so the last time we drain this, guys, let's make sure to give it a couple seconds to just let all that water, or as much of the water as you can, just let it all drain out because we need to measure a certain amount for the cooking process too. So try and get excess water wicked away. Looking pretty good there.
Okay.
This should take about 45 minutes or so. Take about 45 minutes. It's only, you know, it's only a few ounces of beans, guys. So, you know, we're not cooking a big pot for the whole family. So, it won't take long.
Shout out to the Haggerty's.
Yes.
They saw that you were taking a sip of the beer.
Oh, yeah. Guys, it's wonderful. The fall classic. I'm sipping on it.
We were gifted some beers for Christmas.
Sorry, Chris. Chris wants one.
The Haggerty's family that are huge supporters.
Thank you, guys. Yeah, I opened the fridge and that was there, and I was very happy. I feel like we definitely earned this beer today. Almost to a boil. So my rice is drained off. It's time to start cooking it. So I got my small pot here. We can just get our rice into the pot. all that stuff. You could smell it already, the basmati, how fragrant it is. It's almost like a floral, like, aroma to me. I don't know how to describe it. It just smells delicious already. Okay, rice is in there. I'm gonna shake it to get it nice and even. Maddie Swank just showed up. So dumb. Okay, so again, we have this turmeric paste. As soon as you open it, you can smell that stuff. This stuff is no joke, it's strong. Turmeric, lemongrass, ginger, some garlic in there. Mainly it's for the turmeric. So if you are not keen to intense flavors, you're not gonna wanna use the entire amount that we gave you. Gave you about an ounce, ounce and a half. Maybe start with half. You can always taste it if you like. But I'm gonna use all of it for my taste. But again, if you're not keen on very intense flavors that taste like this smells, maybe just use a little bit less. So what I'll do is I'll get some warm water from the sink. Let that guy heat up a little bit. Actually, you know what I'm gonna do? I'm gonna grab some warm water from my boiling pot of beans over here. Oh, look it, we're boiling, guys. Boiling, if you've reached a boil, turn it down. I actually have a simmer function over here. So I'm gonna turn down a simmer. You guys can put it down to low or like a one, you know, one or two. We just want gentle cooking at this point, no more boiling. And we're gonna keep that lid on so that the heat doesn't escape the pot. But before I do that, I'm gonna just grab some of this hot water. And all I did, guys, was just grab some of that hot water and mix it with my paste. Just to kind of get it activated, basically. So it's not this lumpy paste. I'm just gonna give it a quick mix. Doesn't need to be perfect. We just wanna, again, just like kind of get it thinned out a little bit. And so now we could just add our water directly to here for the rice, okay? So we have 8 ounces of rice. We're gonna want somewhere between, you know, 8 to 12 ounces of water, depending on your pot, So let's start off with 8. So that would be half of this guy, half of this container that the rice came in. It's a 16 ounce. You already see it's turning gold. We can go directly into our rice with this stuff. And again, that flavor is intense, y'all. So make sure you're cooking to taste. I'm just inspecting for any like lumpy paste that may be left over, and I look pretty good. Looking pretty good. And so now we can go onto the stove with this guy. And again, we'll bring it up to a boil, reduce it to a simmer, cover it, and let it do its thing. And I'm gonna go like probably not so high, maybe a little. I'm like medium high, guys. I'm like a, if there was a 1 to 10 scale, I'd be at a 7, 7, 8. On the rice. So again, we're gonna bring it up to boil, reduce to a simmer, put the lid on, let it do its thing.
Tell me a little bit about that paste. What's in there?
Paste. So what do we have in that paste? So we got some lemongrass in there. We got some ginger, some turmeric. Turmeric is the main ingredient. It's meant to turn the rice, mainly for flavor, obviously, but to turn the rice gold. So we have our gold component. Ginger, garlic, did I say those already? Lemongrass, turmeric. I think that's it. All right, how we doing, guys? Let me know how you're doing. If you have any questions, I know we're moving kind of fast today. If you have any questions, drop them in the chat. Otherwise, we're gonna keep on moving along. Next step, I've already got my fish out, and it's not gonna go back in the fridge from this point. We want it to temper. We wanna get that, you know, we want it to be less cold. Because we put cold things into hot pans or hot oil, it causes the temperature of the whole environment to drop too. Could cause weird things, especially when we're trying to achieve like this nice crispy situation. We want to just make sure that, you know, we're not adding, you know, we're not messing with the temperature too much. So we're gonna, we're just gonna let this sit out of the fridge. So while it's sitting out, we can also season it. And another thing to take into account too, guys, is look at your fillets. Everybody got 1 pound. But everybody's gonna have a different assortment of sizes, thicknesses, and all that stuff. Just make sure that you can fit all this stuff in your pan. That's, I mean, you may need to cut something or cut it in half. Like, this one's a little big, but luckily I have like that nice wide pan. So I'm not gonna cut it, I'm just gonna leave it as is. But just, you know, you gotta use a little bit of instinct here. Make sure that your fish fits in your pan. So we'll season our fish now. I'm gonna get some kosher salt, and I hear my rice doing stuff. Very chef-y seasoning here. I'm seasoning liberally with salt on both sides. And the trick is to just do it as high as possible. It's because we like to make messes.
Here's and chef, once we get our fish seasoned, let's get a quick recap and rundown of where we're at.
Yes, of course. Fish is seasoned, wash my hands. Oh, my rice is boiling. Almost boiling. And try not to play around with it too much, guys. Don't mess around with it. When you do more friction, just like how when we were rinsing it, it's gonna cause more starch to release, and we wanna avoid that as much as possible. So I have reached a boil. I'm going down to simmer. Literally, this thing says simmer. Amazing. Lid goes on. Rice.
Okay, quick recap.
Quick recap. Okay, what have we done? We have drained and rinsed our beans, brought them to a boil with about an inch and a half or 2 inches of water above the beans, I mean, volume-wise. Brought them to a boil, reduced to a simmer, and then put the lid on. So those guys are just cooking away nice and slow. The rice, we rinsed it as well, put it in our pot, our smaller pot. Then we got our turmeric paste, and we mixed it with a little bit of warm water to kind of thin out that paste a little bit. And then we added about 10 ounces of water to the 8 ounces of rice, brought it to a boil. Rice, water, 10 ounces or so, turmeric paste that's been thinned out with warm water. All went into a pot, brought to a boil, and now reduced to simmer and cooking. We have also taken our fish out of the fridge, got it seasoned liberally on both sides with salt. And we're gonna let that chill. We're not even gonna work with this yet. Just gonna let the salt do its thing, let that temperature go up a little bit. And now I think is a good time to start getting into some knife work. We can get on our cutting boards, guys. Oh, let me just clean up my salt mess. Over here trying to be salt bae and whatnot, you know?
Not salt bae.
Chef, we got a salt question over
salt
here.
Question.
If they don't have kosher salt.
That's okay, use whatever you got. Any salt that you got is fine. I use kosher salt. Because that's just what we learned in restaurants. We don't use any other kind of salt. So this is specifically diamond crystal kosher salt, if you guys want to use the same stuff as me. Like, I could literally count the amount of grains that I'm using.
What salt are you using, Alicia?
I'm using pink Himalayan salt.
There you go.
Okay, a player from the Himalayas.
It all works. You don't want to use too, it shouldn't be too coarse when we're seasoning like this.
No, it's fine. The fine kind.
Yep, there you go. If you have like a grinder, that's good too, because you can cover more surface area with less salt. Okay, so fish is seasoned. Next step is to go through our knife work, guys. So let's get our cutting board out. We're gonna get our nice sharp knife out. And we'll need our mixing bowl as well. Most things are gonna go into here. A little bit. Salt there. Okay, what should we do first? What do you wanna cut first, Alicia? Pick something.
let's do the bell peppers.
Okay, let's do the bell peppers. All right, so not many of these things, guys. First step will be, and I think the shape that we're gonna go for is like a fine dice, very small fine dice, okay? So the first thing that we need to do is remove the stem. So we just stem off like so. And go through and do all of those. Ooh, my knife is nice and sharp today. Okay, next, what I'm gonna do is opposite of the stem end, I'm gonna lob off that little section as well. So now we have these two flat edges on either side of the pepper. Okay, next, I'm gonna stand it on one of those flat edges And I'm gonna cut straight down to split that bell pepper like that. Everybody following me here? So we'll split our bell pepper, boom. And just kind of unravel, unfold it. Oops. Boom. Now what we can do is we want to, this white stuff, these ribs in here, it's actually quite bitter. It's not a pleasant taste. So we want to get rid of that. Anytime we're working with bell peppers, I try and get rid of that. So now that it's kind of filleted open like this, we can just, with our hand, just kind of flatten it a little bit. And then very carefully with your knife, you can just hold it parallel to the cutting board. And just back and forth motion, we're going to remove those ribs. That is garbage. So now we have nice, clean bell pepper. And some might not have a lot of the rib stuff, which is good. That's work for you. Ribs coming out. This guy got a lot of it. Very careful when you're doing this, guys. Whenever you're doing any kind of cuts like this, just make sure you got a nice solid grip on your knife. I like to pinch with my thumb on this part of the knife just so I can have a lot of control. It helps me prevent cutting yourself, being in control of your knife. And then I'm just doing this back and forth. And we're gonna do this on the habanero too, guys, so you get some good practice on this technique. Boom. Nice clean bell peppers, no ribs. Now we can prep them for the fine dice. Fine dice. So what we'll do is we want to get some strips first. I'm going pretty small here. Okay. Strips first. We'll go through and get all stripped up. Strip, 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 strip.
Alicia, how'd you celebrate New Year's Eve?
I cleaned my house and I had a toast with a girlfriend, socially distanced in the backyard. And that was about it. I kept it real mellow. How about y'all?
I did absolutely nothing. So I actually got sushi.
Oh, that sounds so good.
I got sushi, but I dropped it all on the floor.
Oh,
so I ended
hell
up just
no
eating wine for dinner. But I, nice. I did. I salvaged like two pieces of floor nigiri. That's basically what I had. That was my New Year's, and I watched TV with a couple pieces of floor nigiri and some good wine.
Oh, honey.
We here, 2021. Yeah. We here.
The way to start the year, brother. Love it. Okay, so I've gone through and I've prepped all of my bell peppers into these like kind of strip situations right here. Can everybody see that? All right, we're going pretty fine on this cut. So now that we've got them into strips, we can just kind of line them up and we'll cut perpendicular now to that strip. Important to have a nice short knife, guys. Your knife's not that sharp. Maybe try doing them in smaller bunches. Hmm. Bust it in half, maybe. All right. And now what I'm gonna do, wow, can I get this right, guys? Okay, seriously? Bell pepper. All right, so I'm just gonna kind of hold them tight together and we'll just take our time. Sneaking through, but we'll get back to them. Still got some strips in there, need to be cut now. Just take your time with it, guys. It's okay if yours aren't as small as mine, it'll still taste pretty much the same. And here we have it. The full bust down on the bell pepper.
Bell pepper bust down.
All right, bell pepper is going into the bowl. And those little ends that we cut off too, those can just get, we can just roughly chop those up so we don't waste anything. Just go through those a couple times. Boom, 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 boom. Try to avoid those seeds too, guys. The seeds are bitter, gross. Really, they change the, will change your dish. So try and avoid the seeds.
How your bell peppers looking, Alicia?
They're looking good. I had a smaller bell pepper, so I just added a red and a green.
Nice.
For color.
Color's about to be popping.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Okay. I think now would be, actually, we should save the habanero for last, because when we cut that, the oils from this get everywhere, and literally it will turn anything spicy. So let's do the habanero last. We can move on to now, we can do scallion. So nothing crazy here. We're just going to line up the root ends. If you have multiple, or depending on how many you have, lob off those root ends. It's trash. And again, we're gonna try and go thin, guys. The trick with cutting thin is to just take your time. Let your knife get full, nice full strokes, and use that full, not the full length of that blade to get those nice thin cuts. And so we'll go through the scallion whites first. And we're going to cut all the way until we get to that bright green stuff, which is happening to me right now. So this is all scallion whites. Those can go in the bowl with the bell pepper now. And then the greens, we're not going to mix those in immediately. We're going to set those off to the side, and we'll mix them in at the end once we get the black-eyed peas in. Same thing with the greens, though, guys. Take your time. Line them up. And again, just these long, nice full strokes, getting that full motion. Nice thin cuts.
Chef, you think our rice is pretty much close to done by now?
Nah. Rice is going to take about 20 minutes, I'd say.
If you were a little light on the water, can someone add a little more water?
It's tough with rice, guys. It's one of those situations where once it's going, you don't really want to mess with it. But if you feel like your rice needs more water, if you have that kind of instinct, go for it. There's not really any right way to do it. You just got to kind of do it quickly. Try not to let too much steam escape. Okay, there we go. So I'm just gonna save my scallion greens. I'm gonna set those to the side for now. Again, we're gonna put those in at the end of the salad once we get the black-eyed peas in. Nice. Scallions busted down. All right.
What we got next?
Cucumber.
We're busting cucumbers down.
Yes, sir. So I'm going to take off both ends of my cucumber and then just take a bite. I make sure it's not tasting weird, because cucumber can taste weird sometimes. I'm going to use about half of my cucumber.
Okay.
Feel free to use the whole thing if you guys are cucumber fiends or something like that. You just love cucumbers so much. But I'm going to use about half. Okay. We're going to go for a very similar size here. We want everything to be about the same size. Okay. So here's how I prep my cucumber. So I've got these two flat edges. I just stand it up. I'm going to cut one flat face off of one side of the cucumber. Okay. Boom. Now what we're left with is this, you know, this nice stable piece of fruit.
Cucumber's fruit?
Yeah.
Yep.
Word?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yep.
Seeds, bro.
Seeds?
Yeah.
Okay. I feel like it's, I've always been counting it as a veggie. I'm like getting my veggies in. You know what I'm saying?
You've been counting wrong, dog. Okay, so now that we've got this nice flat situation, now we can start cutting some nice strips of our cucumber. So, like that.
Our camera crew did not trust you on that. And,
no? Are we getting a back check?
We Googled it, and you're correct.
Oh, that's right.
It's a fruit.
Thank you. Thank you to my glorious team, guys. So, yeah, I'm just cutting these nice planks almost, guys. Okay, and so here's what we're left with. All right, I've got some interesting size situations going on right here, but that's okay.
Honey, let me see your sizes.
Oh, yeah. Sorry, I keep forgetting that you're on a different camera.
Oh, nice.
OK. Okay. Okay. So those are like planks. I would say maybe quarter of an inch thick. No thicker than that.
Okay.
So again, we're going to do the thing when we cut them into strips, cut them all into strips, and then we'll go perpendicular, cut them all into a small dice. So with these planks, you can just make some nice strips. Sharp knife, very important, guys. Strip, strip, strip. And the seeds are totally fine in this. Love it. Love the seeds in this dish. I'm going to peek at my rice, actually, guys, because someone's getting close. That means I must be getting close, too. Smells good. Doesn't smell burnt. That's a good start.
Rice check.
Rice check. I'm going to do a little taste test. Don't need some more time. It's just about there, though.
Is there a bean check, or do we just let them ride?
Beans are there, and we're going to let them ride.
Just let them ride?
Yeah, let them ride. You got to let those things ride, man. Let them just do their thing. My rice is 80% cooked, so you guys should be around that point, too. So leave it on the simmer. I'll let mine simmer for a couple more minutes. Just taste it. I mean, I can tell it's not finished, obviously. So I'm going to let it keep cooking. Maybe yours is finished, though. Just taste it. All right, so I've got these strips of cucumber. And again, just like we did with the bell peppers, cut those guys into this little dice.
Hi, Charlie.
And this is what we're getting here. And those go straight into the bowl as well. These scallions over, my dude. You guys over here. Okay. I'll just finish those up there.
Nice, nice.
Cucumbers.
Cucumbers donezo.
Donezo. And we got these little edge pieces too that we can just quickly.
I'm gonna chef speed on them one time.
Yeah, sorry about that, guys. I missed one. Okay. Cucumbers in the bowl. We're doing great. You guys are doing awesome. I know you have beautiful knife cuts going on because you're taking your time and your knife is nice and sharp. Good job. I'm so proud of you. Next thing we can do is get our lime. What we want to do is we want to macerate. We want to start to just kind of let everybody marry together in this bowl, all these different flavors that are happening. Just kind of activate and wake them up a little bit. And acid is a great way to do that. So we'll cut our lime in half. I'll start with half of a lime, just see how much juice that yields. We don't want it swimming in lime juice, honestly. It doesn't need to be swimming. But we do want to have enough so that everybody can be in the pool. That half of a lime was plenty for me.
Damn lime. A little frustration. I got a little frustration on that lime, my guy.
We'll hit it, guys, with a nice pinch of salt as well at this point. I'm gonna do a little extra one too. And we're going to mix it. Just give it a quick mix, let everybody meet each other in there. Bell peppers, the onions, the cucumbers. Okay. We have two more things to add to this salad. One is the parsley. So we can take our parsley out of the bag. And it's okay if you get a little cilantro mixed into it, not a big deal. It's not gonna make or break. We're going to go full stem, full leaf, everything. We want the whole situation. And we're just going to bust this down, guys. Really just spend some time going through that parsley. Have some fun.
When you guys have a free hand not cutting, I want you guys to give me some goals or resolutions in this chat too, so I can see what you guys are working on in the chat.
Yeah, guys, tell us about what 2021 looks like for you.
We used about half the cucumber, Garrett. We used half that cucumber. We cut it into strips.
I used half. Again, you guys can use as much as you like. I used half just for the ratio purposes. But again, it's not a make or break thing. So I've busted down my parsley quite a bit here. I've run my knife through it probably 6 or 7 times, and now it's like getting like kind of wet. And I don't know how else to describe it other than busted down.
Alicia, did you have a question there? Did we cut you off from something?
No, I was just asking if you were cutting the parsley down.
Oh, yeah. Sorry, I didn't even hear that.
Yeah,
we're busting it down. Like literally just go through it probably 6 or 7 times with your knife. A little rinse there.
Alicia, do you have any 2021 goals or objectives, or I don't know if you do resolutions, anything like that?
I don't do resolutions. I'm a Capricorn, so I don't know. I'm like a perfectionist. I can't do resolutions. but things that I'm going to keep doing this year include working out, getting on my bike 4 times a week, trying as many good recipes as I possibly can.
Nice. Yes. All right, guys.
I think
so
my rice is my done.
Yeah, you're probably close.
Yeah, my rice. If you just caught that, I tasted my rice one more time. It's like 95% finished. So what I've done is I've just removed it from the heat. I'm gonna let it just steam a little bit by itself. Let it just finish cooking, and then we'll pop the top off in a little bit, fluff it up, and it should be ready. And now we can work with our habanero. So we're gonna do something very similar to what we did with the bell peppers. So take off both ends. The spiciness of this chili really lies in the seeds and in the ribs. Bell peppers obviously are not spicy, so we don't have to worry about that. But with the habanero, we should worry about that. These things are really hot, you guys. So if you are not keen to pain in your mouth, you might wanna use a little bit less than what I'm using. I'll use about half of this habanero, by the way. You want some spice on yours? You good with spice?
I can take it, man.
Good with spice. About that,
I eat nigiri off the floor, my guy. I can take a little spice.
Okay. I have a weird part on mine, so I'm just going to remove that. Okay, guys. Same situation as a bell pepper. Top and tail off. And then we're going to split it. So just cut down one wall of that pepper. And then again, just take your time and remove those ribs and those seeds.
No ribs, no seeds, no sticks.
Okay. And this guy's going in the salad?
Yes, this is gonna go in the salad. So once you get rid of those ribs and those seeds of the habanero, it's really not as spicy. I'm telling you, all the spice lies right in here. You don't believe me? Touch your lip after touching this. So we've removed it. The flavor of habanero is great though. It's like very fruity and floral. So now we're left with just kind of a little bit of spice that's just residual because it's a chili. But then we just get that full flavor. We can use quite a bit of the habanero. So same thing, but we want to go as small as possible with these cuts. Okay, so just take your time, guys. Same thing we do with the bell pepper. And I'm cutting super thin strips. Man, I'm just gonna use this whole thing since Ryan Royce thinks he can handle spice.
Yeah.
Let's do it, bro.
Something like it hot.
You want a little piece of this raw pepper, right?
Nah, I'm good.
You good?
Now.
Okay, he's
ass. But once we get it popping,
you don't want to do all that. You don't want that smoke. All right, so I'll cut them into super thin strips. And now we'll bust them down into very, very fine dice. And just make sure you don't have any large pieces, I'm telling you. Like, just look through it, because this stuff will burn you, okay? Habanero's going in, the whole thing, here at the Last Supper Society kitchen. And after you cut your habanero, you must wash your hands, because if you touch your face, or like I've done many times, go try and use the bathroom after cutting lots of chili.
Hey!
That's not a pleasant experience. So please wash your hands, guys. Mm-hmm. That's good.
How you doing with your knife work, Alicia? You caught up? You here with us?
Yeah, I'm all set. I'm
just easy mode, right? All right, mix those habaneros in.
Off.
And our salad is almost finished. It's just awaiting the black eyed peas. So now it's just gonna kind of break down. Those flavors are gonna meld together and we're just gonna forget about it for a little while. Avocado will go last as well. he's underground. They're trying to signal me something.
Making sure that Alicia can see, if we're not blocking anything.
Yes,
there.
Yes, of course, of course. Okay, so I am putting my cutting board and my knife away for a little bit. We'll get back to that when we need to cut our avocado later. But now it's time for the fish situation. So what we will need, guys, we need two containers, basically. Or two vessels, I should say. They're like trying to signal me all kinds of stuff. And
no, you're lit.
I'm not.
Get it popping.
I'm just not following it. I'm not following along. Okay.
Alicia, your salad looked fire, by the way.
Thank you.
All right, guys.
All right.
So let's get set up to fry some fish. You'll need two vessels. One of those vessels is going to take our panko and coconut mix. And before you dump this out, just like kind of give it a shake in there, just to kind of mix it up.
I'm missing an ingredient.
I wonder if it fell out when my bag broke.
What are you looking for, my guy?
My egg. Where the heck is my egg? I think it fell out when my bag broke at the other apartment.
We're all right. Let's keep it moving.
Yeah, we're going to keep moving. Matt, my car is downstairs. Can you go run and grab eggs from the back seat, please? Thank you. Matt's going to go grab some eggs for us because I seem to have lost mine. But that's okay. We'll keep it moving, guys. So one container is, or one vessel is going to have our panko and shredded coconut. The other one, you guys can go ahead and do this now. The other container, I'm just going to pretend like I'm cracking an egg right here. You're going to crack your egg into the container like this. Okay, check for shells. And then you're going to add, I would say, a splash of water.
Just one egg, Alicia, yes.
One egg is fine.
Yep.
One egg is just fine. And you'll want to get a splash of water in there, too, to kind of thin it out so it's not so thick. And make sure you mix that stuff real, real good, guys. You shouldn't see any strands of egg. Here, let's give Matt some keys. Here, my jacket. So, Alicia, talk to me about the brown one, bro. The brown one. Talk to me about your fried fish method. Like, what is your style of frying fish?
Well, it depends. I just got an air fryer recently, so I'm kind of obsessed with that. Last night, I did the regular oil method, so I do about 2 inches of oil in a cast iron. I might have a cast iron, like, frying pan, basically. Mm-hmm. It's a little bit deeper than the regular pans for frying. Mm-hmm. And then I do... Last night I did, because I was tired, I did a Zatarain's fish fry, but usually mm-hmm, I make mm-hmm. my own batter.
Okay.
And I do a little bit of flour, cayenne, paprika, onion mm-hmm. powder, garlic powder, salt, pepper. Yep. And making sure that the seasoning is more than the flour, because
I feel that you got to have it in there.
You want to taste the seasoning. I also always like to use a little seasoned salt after I take the fish out of the fry.
Yes. Salting after it's coming out of the fryer is so important. I feel like that's a step that a lot of home cooks miss, and like something that we definitely focus on a lot in restaurants. Like, you have to season, because typically the batter, I mean, it may have seasoning in it, but like even just a little salt, you know, if there's not,
yeah.
you know, a little salt at the end really good. Does a lot.
That's right. That's right. How about you? How do you usually fry your fish?
Do you usually use this method? Yeah, I mean, it totally depends. Like, if it's going in a taco, you know, I want to do like a beer batter, or like a you know, like a tempura batter almost. That's probably my favorite
way
to do it.
That sounds
but
so good.
This method is great too. Like the like a shallow fry is what this is going to be. It's not fully submerged in the oil, and again, we're going to finish it in the oven. So it's kind of like a hybrid, like fry and bake situation, which is pretty cool. The texture of the fish really benefits from that kind of cooking process.
That's going to be great. And what kind of oil are you using right now? You said coconut oil?
No. So the oil that we included in the kits is rice bran oil. It can get real hot. So it's great for frying. And again, and the flavor of it is real dope too. I love this stuff.
I don't have rice bran premium oil. If I don't have rice bran oil, what should I use?
You can use any. I wouldn't suggest using olive oil.
That's not good for it.
Canola oil would work great. Vegetable oil would work great.
Got you.
Olive oil just, it doesn't, it's not able to get as hot as we need it to get before it starts to burn and smoke. So careful with that, guys. Okay, so I'm going to actually start getting my oil ready, so that when that egg magically arrives, I can just get right into frying. So what I'll do, we may not need all of this on our end. We'll see though. Basically what we want, guys, is we want a solid layer of oil in our pan. Like it needs to be, you know, it doesn't need to be very high. Again, we're not deep frying this, but it does need to be like a solid, solid pool of oil in there. And I think I'm just going to
Alicia, we have a question in the chat asking, where were you born and raised?
Born and raised in the Bay Area, actually. Lived in San Rafael. I lived in Tiburon. And I've been in Oakland for almost 20 years. Lived in San Francisco for a year or so. I'm a Bay Area girl.
I miss Oakland, man. I love Oakland. I used to live Lake Merritt area.
Oh, nice. Me too. I'm in the West now.
Man, it was the best time.
Yeah.
The best time.
I used to live right around 54th and MLK. Mm-hmm. So, like, North Oakland. Then I moved to the by the lake. I used to live, like, up the street from Whole Foods, and then I was in the East for about 14 years, and now I'm in the West.
West Oakland.
Really all over, yeah.
Okay, so hopefully you guys are following along. You should have your egg cracked with a little bit of water in one bowl or vessel or container. It doesn't really matter what it is. You should have your panko and coconut mixture in another vessel. And I'm still waiting for an egg here. So
let's talk them through it. Let's just talk them through it.
Okay, so I've added my oil to the pan, guys. We can get a flame under that. We're gonna start heating it up. I'm not using a thermometer here. We're not doing, need to lock that. We're just gonna go off of just a few different, you know, there's a couple cues that we can look for when we're frying to know that our oil is ready. So we'll get it under pretty high flame. I'm not full whack here. I'm like, I would say, you know, at a 7 or 8. We don't want to get too hot too fast. So 7 or 8 on the Richter scale. Take a peek at my beans one time. Give them a little taste here. Oh, it's hot. Beans are doing all right. I think they need a little bit more time. My preference. Oil's getting nice and hot. So what we're looking for with the oil, guys, if you don't have a thermometer, which I don't have a thermometer, what we can do is we can just kind of just pinch in a couple little pieces of that breading. And you'll see it, if the oil's ready, you'll see it start to fry. It'll start to get little bubbles around it. It'll kind of start to dance around the pan. That's how you know your oil's ready. So mine is not dancing yet. So, okay, so let's talk about breading this fish, okay? The first thing you're gonna wanna do is dip one side of the fish into the egg mixture. We're only gonna be coating or breading one side of this fish, by the way. It's not a double-sided situation. So get it into that egg mixture, and directly from the egg mixture, I'm gonna go into the panko and coconut. And when you do that, just kind of use your fist or your palm, whatever works, and just give some good gentle pressure downwards. All right. I can see those little pieces starting to dance around a little bit more, so I know we're getting close. And really, guys, just push it in there. Get it coated, man. Use a little elbow grease. And try and keep the batter off of the other side, or not the batter, the breading off the other side. And even without the egg, we have this nice coating. You guys with me? And so what I want to do is I want to bread all my fish first so that we're not going back and forth and we can get rid of this setup. So egg, yeah.
Got a little test for you, chef.
What's that?
If someone is working with the thermometer, how hot should oil be?
We want to go 350 to 400. Got an egg, you guys. Oh, my oil's smoking now. Okay, so I'm turning the oil down. And we can get back to our regularly scheduled program. Thank you, Matt, for doing that. Okay, egg. Boom, crack it. Little splash of water in there, boom. Crazy. And I have a fork in here. Bust this egg down one time. And I've turned my heat down on my oil because it started to smoke. So watch out for that, guys.
So where should we be at now?
I can't tell you where we should be at. Is we should be at oil not smoking. And if we drop a little bit of the breading in there, it should immediately start to bubble up, fry, and do its thing. Start to kind of dance around there. If you have oil that does that, then you are ready to fry. All right, just getting this egg wash mixed up. Chef speed here. All right, so again, egg. Egg getting nice and happy. All right, breading. Pressure, push. Remove. How's that? Everybody okay? You guys good? Do this last piece.
So again, we're only doing one side, correctly?
One side. We're only breading one side, guys. One side.
Oh, oops.
If you did both sides, it's totally fine. You'll probably want to fry both sides then. The oven is probably not going to do its thing for you if you've breaded both sides. Pressure, push, and we're frying, guys. It makes a mess. There's nothing you can do to avoid it, so get a little messy with it. Okay, that's looking pretty good to me. And now that I've got my last piece breaded, actually, I want to get that little corner a little bit better right there. All right, we're all breaded up. Another little test. Looking good. Fish going in.
What was that lay down technique? Let me see that lay down one more time.
I'll run it back one time. And so now that I've got this cold, again, not cold, but like colder than the oil, fish introduced to the oil, my oil temperature dropped immediately. So what I want to do is I want to get some more heat under there. So I've gone back up to about medium high, I'd say. And each time we put a new piece in, it's going to drop that temperature again. So just keep that in mind. Like, we can honestly just keep it on medium high as we're adding all of our fish and try and space it out a little bit so that you can let it recover some temperature. But this is what we're looking for. It shouldn't be splattering. If it's splattering, your oil's a little bit too hot. Oh, the lay down technique. I don't know how to describe it. It's more like a...
Okay. Like a... I can see that.
I'll do it one more time. This is how you avoid burning your hand with hot oil. Re-bread this guy. So I just pinch the top of the fish, and I'm going to lay it away from me. So just in case it falls, the oil splashes out, as opposed to laying it like this and the oil potentially splashing towards my body. Boom. Fish is frying. And all we're trying to do here, guys, we are not trying to cook the fish completely in the oil right now. All we're trying to do is develop nice golden brown crust on that one side. And again, we're gonna finish it in the oven. So don't worry about fully cooking the fish right now. Let's just focus on getting nice golden brown.
So we're crust side down, guys.
Crust side down, guys. We're frying the crust. Maybe turn the temperature down a little bit as it starts to cook. I'm like medium-ish. And now your tool of choice here is important when we're moving this stuff, because we don't wanna disturb the breading too much. So I like to use either spatula or tongs. I'm just gonna give this a little check real quick. Looking pretty good so far. This is the first piece I put in.
How's yours looking, Alicia?
I think it's looking good. I'm gonna flip it soon.
Yeah, so Alicia's gonna have to flip since she breaded both sides. So
yeah, if you guys breaded both sides, don't worry about it, it's not a big deal. Just fry, make sure you fry both sides. And so here's what we got. Starting to get that nice golden brown developing. It's not quite ready yet. This is actually really hot in my hand. I don't know why I grabbed this. But that's okay. We got some golden brown developing. And again, we're gonna cook it in a pretty hot oven. So that crust will crisp up even more in the oven. But we're trying not to burn it. We're just gonna take our time with it. Get that nice golden brown. Should smell coconut, lots of coconut. Almost there, you guys. Let it drip a bit. Flip it.
So it should be, if you did both sides, it's time to flip.
Yeah. And you can feel that crispy.
Smells delicious already.
Huh? How do you grab that? I don't know. Sometimes when you grab hot stuff like that, you just kind of have to just keep going with it. You can't just drop it or throw it, you know? You gotta just endure the pain. All right, last piece. Looking beautiful. Boom. And that's it. We're done with the hot oil, guys. The fryer is being turned off. And now if you guys are here, found a hair, sorry. I was gonna give that one to Ryan. Okay, so all the fish is out, oil's off, oven's on. We're gonna go in the oven, but make sure that all your other components are lit and ready to go as well. The fish can stay like this for a while we get everything ready. So I'm just gonna put this over here, let you guys catch up a little bit. I think it's even a good time to finish our salad because we want that fish, once it goes into the oven, we can't stop it. So. Let's get everything else ready for the plating. And that involves getting our salad whooped up. I'm just gonna move my fryer situation over like that. Let's check our beans, guys. I tasted mine about 10 minutes ago or so, and they were finished.
All right, you flipping over there, Alicia?
Mm-hmm. What are we doing with these beans? Are we seasoning those or
lime juice? We'll season them in the pan or in the bowl with the salad. So what I've done now is I have poured out the water that they cooked in. And what I'm going to do, this is going to look and sound crazy, but we're just going to run cold water over these beans. I'm gonna cool them down. Don't forget, these are for a salad, all right? Typically, to cool things down in like a restaurant situation, we'd use an ice bath, but I don't want to use ice here today because that ice might act as an abrasive kind of situation in there. Cause the beans to like smash up and get weird. So I'm just gently gonna cool these down by running cold water. And it'll probably take a couple of rounds of cold water. In the same pot that I cooked them in, guys. Just literally just running cold water.
Okay, guys, we called an audible yesterday. Chef will explain. So, but the Bay Area kits were already shipped off. So Bay Area kits actually have coconut milk.
They have coconut milk. And I called it audible because I tested the dish again with the coconut milk, and the brand of coconut milk that we got, I was not happy with. Happy with using it in this process. It just didn't work. It wasn't right. So if you're in Sacramento, you did not get coconut milk for that reason. If you're in the Bay Area, congratulations, or you're welcome. Happy New Year. You now have some coconut milk to do whatever you want with. But we will not be using it today. Do you have these cold? They're cold. Beautiful. So yeah, I'm just going to strain these off. Get as much liquid out as I can. A little bit of residual liquid won't hurt it. Get our salad here. Beans going in. And now's our chance to season our beans. Give a little mix. And those scallion greens can go into that salad as well now.
Okay. I see you working, Alicia. You're all over that kitchen.
Mix. Okay, give a little taste here. Nice bright salad, the lime juice. The lime juice is gonna play so well with the coconut and the cilantro. Oh, I can't wait to eat this. Salt's good, acid's good. Make sure to taste your food, guys. Taste your food, adjust the seasoning as you see fit. I tend to be a little heavy-handed on the salt, so. All right, so salad's done. Rice is done. Fish going in the oven. This isn't gonna take long, guys. We've already basically cooked the fish halfway. So we'll just finish it off in the oven. It shouldn't take more than 5 minutes or so. And while we're waiting for it, we have one more task with our knife. And now with this avocado, you can either mix it into your salad. They are a little soft, so I'm gonna use them as, I'm gonna use it as more of like a garnishy type thing, but I'll show you.
As we're getting everything in the oven and our salad's done, let's get a quick recap of where we're at on these last few steps here.
Great. Mm-hmm. Okay, where are we at?
Okay, you can come in.
Our fish was fried, battered and fried, egg and then panko coconut. Nice good pressure on there. And then we fried it in our rice bran oil on just one side. If you double battered it on both sides, not the end of the world. Just make sure you fry both sides. But if you did the single batter or a single side batter, we crisped up that side, got it onto a sheet tray, and put it in the oven. The rice came off a while ago. It's just kind of been sitting here. It needs a fluff, but we'll get to that in a second. And our beans were finished. I tasted them. They were done. They're fully cooked. What I did was I ran cold water through the beans quite a few times, drained it out, cold water, drained it out to cool them down. So that they can go into our salad, because warm beans in a salad might be a little weird. The salad was seasoned with salt after I put the beans in, and then I also added in the rest of my scallion greens. Gave it a mix, tasted it, and loved it. We are about to work on our avocado. What's that?
That salad is delicious.
Love it, I'm glad you made it. So we can work on our avocado, guys. Again, if you want to mix it into the salad, that's how I originally planned it, with a less ripe avocado. But these are pretty freaking ripe. So I'm going to, or mine is at least. So I'm going to do a very chefy avocado garnish.
What are you doing with it?
So I've taken the top and the tail off and separate it just like a regular avocado. And I'd like to take that part off because it makes it easy for me to peel by hand. Nice, okay. Skin comes off, guys, right?
I never peel my avocados.
Are you hungry?
So now that we have this beautiful peeled naked avocado, we can do whatever we want. We can cut it we can dice it. I'm gonna do some like super thin, slice
How's your fish doing, Alicia? You good over there?
My fish is done. Hopefully.
All right. So now we can get this nice little like fanned out avocado situation. Fun stuff. All right, my internal chef clock is going off. I think my fish is done. Let's see what's up. And just with a little poke, if you poke the fish, it should be quite firm. Cod firms up when it's fully cooked. So firm is good. Check under. Ooh, it's hot. Fish is done, guys. Oh, God.
So our check for the fish is just firmness?
Firmness, yeah. Literally, just kind of poke at it. You'll feel that it's firmed up. It's quite a different texture than raw fish.
Yep.
Okay, guys. I think all of our components are ready. We just need to kind of fluff up our rice a little bit. And then we can go to the plate. Are you ready to go to the plate, Alicia?
I am ready to go to the plate.
Let's do this. Nice. Well, if we're going to go to the plate, what we like to do, Alicia, when we go to the plate is inspire people to get creative with it. Yeah. So okay. To give you guys a little motivation, we're going to play a little plating music, but whoever has the most fire plating, we want to give you something. We want to give you a little welcome to the new year gift. So take a picture of your plating when you're done. We want you to tag Last Supper Society, at Last Supper Society, and use hashtag the cookin, and we want you to post it on the gram.
Post it on that gram.
We want to see it on the gram, and the winner of the most fire plating gets dinner on us for our next episode. Alicia, you want them to tag you? You want to see what they come up with too?
Yeah, I want to see what y'all doing.
Okay. So tag at Chasing Garza also. We'll put that in the chat. So at Last Supper Society, at Chasing Garza. On the tags and hashtag the cookin. Let's go to the plate. We got some Lauryn Hill to inspire y'all.
Hit it.
So let's get to the plate.
I picked the song.
You guys too, man.
Hey.
The plate up.
I'm keeping it simple, guys. Three pieces of fish. A groupie call you far from temptation. Now you want ball over separation. Tarnish my image in the conversation. Who you gonna scrimmage like you the champion? You might win some, but you just lost one. You might win some, but you just lost one. You might win some, but you just lost one. You might win some, but you just lost one. You might win some, but you just lost one. Now, how come your talk turned cold? You ain't the whole world with the place in your soul. But you can't control. Now you walk lost with a sight to behold. Wisdom is better than silver and gold. I was hopeless, now I'm on hope roll. Every man wanna act like he's exempt. Need to get down on his knees and repent. Can't slick talk under the judgment. The movement similar to a serpent. Try to play straight how your whole style been. Consequences, no coincidence. I wanna see what you got, Alicia. I wanna see what you come up with. Always want to make it seem like good intent. Never want to face it when it's time for punishment. I know you don't want to hear my opinion. How many paths and you must choose one. And if you don't change, then the rain soon comes. See, you might win some, but you just lost one. You might win some, but you just lost one. You might win some, but you just lost one. You might win some, but you just won one. You might win some, but you just might win some. Good so far. So this salad is quite wet and juicy. And I don't want that wet stuff to ruin my crust. So, boy, I'm gonna use a slotted spoon.
Just a simple song, and some don't know what they have to do. Even when you're gone, you can still be
gonna ride the sweet dawn. Now, some might listen and some might shine, and some may think that they've reached perfection. If you look closely, you'll see what you become. Cause you might win some, but you just lost one. You might win some, but you just lost one. You might win some, but you just lost one. You might win some, but you just lost one. You might win some, but you just lost one.
Good. Don't forget about your cilantro, guys. Micro cilantro, it's a garnish guy.
To the beach for 2021. The non-super spreader beach.
Alright, I'm an aguacate. That's Spanish for avocado. And then I'm gonna finish it up.
What's up, Alicia? Ooh!
Going dumb.
With the heat.
There it is.
We're not going to let you win the competition, though.
I know. Ooh. My plate's kind of slipping because
I'm trying. We're going to have you bring it up again at the end so we can just... You can chill for now, but we're going to have you bring it back up and get that, get those good shots.
And I think, guys, wouldn't hurt at the end.
I would get eight.
We'll just do a little drizzle.
Are we gonna do a little olive oil drizzle?
Just olive oil drizzle.
Okay. Just a quick little drizzle, drizzle.
Wow. There it is, man.
Calling it.
Little lime squeeze. XD.
Oh, I forgot my garnish.
Oh. Don't forget the garnish.
Don't forget to garnish, y'all.
All right. Calling it.
We're calling it. This looks beautiful. This looks gorgeous. Well
how
done.
We do. Thank you, sir.
Well done. This is how we nice start job, the guys. Year off. Well done, everybody at home. Well done, Alicia. We had a couple questions. I don't want anyone's food to get cold. And we had a chance to talk about this a little bit, Alicia, before when we talked previously. But I think one of the biggest questions that everyone has is, where do we go from here? Where do we go in 2021? We have this energy, we're activated, we have our intentions set. Where do we go from here to be that change we wanna see?
Yeah, well, I always say the same thing to everybody, so I'll just keep it, I'll keep the same energy in 2021, which mm-hmm. is figure out what you care about. And once you figure that out, then find other people who care about the same thing and join them. And then once you've done that, bring more people along with you. We really do need all hands on deck. And honestly, any lane that you choose, as long as it's yours, just get in it and play your position and do it really well. If what you do is nourish people through food, get in there and do it really well. There's no need for you to be like, oh my God, I've never been to a protest before, so I can't do it. No, that's not what it's about. It's literally about finding out what you care about and taking action to make sure that it's a part of the just world that we're trying to build.
Amazing. Thank you so much. Let's get a final shot of your plate. Because you did set it off. So we want to get that in. Everybody at home, thank you guys so much for choosing to start your year off with the team. We are humbled, we are thankful, we're doing something positive together, we're sharing space and energy to start off the year. So let's continue all these positive things. And again, just like Alicia said, we're gonna keep the same energy, everything positive we were doing in 2020, we're bringing into 2021. Alicia, that plate looks fire. I know your guys at home looks fire too. Post it on the gram, take a flick. Tag at Last Supper Society, tag at Chasing Garza, use hashtag the cook in and keep that same energy in 2021. Thank you guys so much for joining us. This right here is the 2021 Prosperity Plate. Yes. Chef put it down. You guys put it down. We're the Last Supper Society. Peace.
Peace, y'all. Happy New Year.